Hey guys, today we'll discuss about pharmacology of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So what are those drugs, how they act in our body, what is their importance, what are their side effects, we'll discuss everything today. So first we'll start with what are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So we want to understand non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, we should understand what is inflammation, alright. So what is inflammation? What happens during inflammation, for example, let's take this is our cell membrane, right? So this is our cell membrane. What happens during external inflammation? So what is inflammation? Inflammation is an external stimulus, so which is trying to damage our body. What our body should do for that? Our body should prevent that. I mean, the body should take care of the, like, you know, cells itself. So what it will do, it will provide a protective mechanism. So to define simply, what is inflammation? Inflammation is a response of the body to a external stimulus. What happens during the inflammation? So this is our cell membrane. Right. So if this is our cell membrane is made up of what? That is made up of phospholipids. So why I'm going behind this inflammation? Because it's a very important base to understand how they are acting in the body. So whenever there is an external stimulus, what will happen? There is an enzyme called phospholipidase. So phospholipidase, what it means? It will break down the phospholipids. The enzyme comes to action is called phospholipidase. So that is phospholipidase A2. So when this enzyme act on the phospholipids, what will happen? There forms a compound called arachidonic acid. What it is called? Arachidonic acid. So what is this arachidonic acid? Arachidonic acid is a precursor for prostaglandins and many other. So once the arachidonic is formed, here comes the important, important base for the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. That is our enzymes called COX, that is cyclooxygenase. COX is also, complete form is cyclooxygenase. So there are two forms of cyclooxygenase. Let's stop till arachidonic acid. I'll tell a bit about cyclooxygenase, that means COX. So there are two forms in our body, that is COX-1 and COX-2. When they are coming, COX-1 is physiological. What I mean by physiological, it is normally present in our body. So COX-1 is physiological, right? COX-2 is produced only when there is an inflammatory response. But COX-2 can be present only in the some parts of the brain and some parts of the kidney in a physiological condition, but to a very less quantity. But COX-1 is present all over body. I mean, it is present everywhere in the body. So why I'm talking about cyclooxygenase here? Because our non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are the ones which acts on the enzyme called COX. So once the enzyme COX act on this, so that will form our prostaglandins. And another one called as thromboxin. What is it called? Thromboxin. Right. So prostaglandin and thromboxin has formed under the action of COX-1 and COX-2. But when COX-1 is acting, it is produced in the form of physiological way. So it is normal. So COX, the normal physiologically, what happens? The prostaglandins are really required for our body to maintain some protective mechanism. So what is exactly the protective mechanisms of the prostaglandin? That includes protection of our gastric mucosa. And so protection of gastric mucosa, how exactly it will protect our gastric mucosa? It will decrease the acid production. They decrease the acid production. And also, they increase the blood flow to the mucosa. Which mucosa? To the gastric mucosa. So whenever there is a damage, this prostaglandin will stimulate the blood flow and it will stimulate the growth of the mucosa of the stomach. So it means it has a protective mechanism against ulcer in our body, right? So not only here, the prostaglandins also involved in the small vessels such as arterioles. They involve in the vessel resistance maintenance. Why I am telling resistance, but it is not systemical. I mean, it is not all over the body. It is just in the part of the body. So it regulates blood flow to the part of the body. So it involves in the, you know, maintenance of the blood pressure, but not to a high quantity, but a certain extent. Up to an extent, there is a maintenance of the blood pressure. So this is the importance of our prostaglandins, right? What happens during pathological condition, these cogs, one is physiological, I told. What happens during pathological condition, COX-2 is produced. Right. When COX-2 is produced, what is COX-2? COX-2 is an isoform of COX-1, which is like a similar structure, but it has similar different function. Right. So, this is COX-2 is an isoform of the COX-1. What exactly it does? It will increase the production of prostaglandins. When the prostaglandin production is increased, what will happen? So, that is the result of the increased prostaglandin levels. But during inflammation, not only prostaglandins, but there are other factors which stimulate the prostaglandin production. How they stimulate, we'll discuss now. Right. So I told COX-2 comes to action when there is an inflammation, right? So how the stimulation of production, I mean how the COX-2 is stimulated? We have some inflammatory mediators such as tumor necrotic factor alpha, cytokines and interleukins, especially the interleukin 1, right? So what these factors, whatever is produced, inflammatory mediators, during the inflammation, what they will do? They will stimulate. So they stimulate what? The production of the COX. When the COX is produced, increased production of prostaglandins, right? So this will lead to the fever during the inflammation. This will lead to the pain, it will lead to the increased temperature, it will lead to the inflammatory response. Everything is due to elevation of the COX-2 levels. So how exactly our NSAIDs will work, right? So before going to how exactly NSAIDs work, let's discuss little bit about thromboxane. So what is the location of this thromboxane? Thromboxane A2 specially, this one is present in our platelets. So what is the function of our platelets? It involves in the formation of our blood clot, right? So it will stimulate platelet aggregation. So thromboxane A2 is produced due to action of what? Due to action of enzymes called cyclooxygenases. So when it is produced due to action of cyclooxygenases, thromboxane is important when there is a formation of the clot, right? So when there is an impairment, the formation of, there is an impairment of the platelet aggregation. That is the importance, how exactly the NSAIDs act, we'll discuss, right? So what exactly our NSAIDs will do? It will inhibit enzyme COX. So how many forms we have? Here we have COX-1 and COX-2. So let's divide all NSAIDs, I mean the drugs which acts on the cyclooxygenase, into three groups. How we will divide? Based on the inhibitory activity. So let's first discuss that is called classic NSAIDs. So that is non-selective. Non-selective what? Non-selective COX inhibitors. Right. we have preferable selective. I mean, those are little bit selective towards. I mean, they preferably, they mostly inhibit COX-2, but they have a little action on COX-1 also. So that is preferable COX-2 inhibitors. When I'm putting minus here, which means inhibition. We have another one, selective COX. Which one we should inhibit? We should inhibit only COX-2 because it is only the one which is mediating our inflammation. So that is selective COX-2 inhibitors. Right. Let's name the drugs. That includes non-selective, majorly important one, that is aspirin. So the drugs, whatever comes under non-selective is also called as classical non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So which means they inhibit both enzymes, right? So we have diclofenac sodium. We have pyroxicam. We have indomethacin. We have ketrolac. We have pyroxicam, aspirin, diclofenac. We have ibuprofen. We have many other drugs based on, like, we have another classification for these drugs, especially for the non-selective ones, based on how they are derived. For example, when you take aspirin, the aspirin is a derivative of acetyl salicylic acid, which I am not going into right now. And we have preferable selective COX-2 inhibitors. So that include majorly the nimesulid, and meloxicam. Right. So, selective COX-2 inhibitors, that is celecoxib, rifacoxib, and other one is paracoxib. So, how they exactly, like, you know, does function in our body and what are the side effects, what are their indication, we'll discuss now. So, I told aspirin is a very special drug over here. Why aspirin is a special drug? I'm gonna remove the names of the drugs here so that I can explain the mechanism. Right. When we have other ones and the aspirin is totally different from the other type of the NSAIDs. Why? Because it will inhibit COX, right? COX inhibitory. But how? Especially the special mechanism of aspirin, that is irreversible inhibition. So what I mean by irreversible inhibition, once the COX is inhibited anywhere in the body by aspirin, it is not going to come back to its normal state. So whenever there is an inhibition of aspirin, COX with aspirin, that COX, whatever was present, is lost. For example, how the thromboxanes were produced in our RBC? Thromboxanes were produced in our platelets by action of our COX enzyme. When we inhibit the COX enzyme, there is no thromboxane formed. So what is the function of thromboxane? Thromboxane involves in the formation of clot. So when we inhibit COX in the red blood cell, there is no clot formation. I mean, there is no platelet aggregation, right? So this irreversible property of COX is majorly used in cardiovascular system diseases. Why? Because let's take a patient with myocardial infarction, for example, atherosclerosis. What happens? Whenever there is a rupture of atheroma, what will happen? There will be platelet aggregation, then it will lead to clot formation and occlusion of the artery. So to avoid that, what we will do? We use aspirin. How we use aspirin here? It is in the low dose. Why I am using it in a low dose? Because COX is widely present in our platelets, right? Why I am telling majorly an aspirin? Because other drugs are reversible inhibitors. So these are the drugs which reversible inhibitors. So when I'm talking about preferable COX-2 inhibitors, they have inhibitory action on both COX-1 and COX-2, but they mostly inhibit, I mean, most effect on the COX-2, least effect on the COX-1. And we have selective COX-2, they actually only inhibit COX-2. Whenever there is inflammation, put this drug, COX-2 inhibited, so there is no abnormal production of the prostaglandin. When there is no abnormal production of the prostaglandins, what will happen? So there is no inflammatory response, whatever was formed, right? So this is the mechanism of action of NSAIDs. Let's discuss, when I explain the mechanism, so it has, all NSAIDs have three properties, right? What are those three properties? Anti-inflammatory, so we have antipyretic, and analgesic. Right. So when they have these three properties, so let's use these properties. We'll discuss the indications now. So whenever there is a anti-inflammatory property, we can use this drug to the inflammatory diseases. Let's take chronic inflammatory diseases. For example, we have such something called as rheumatic arthritis. Right. So not only rheumatic arthritis, we use it in chronic inflammatory diseases, other diseases such as osteoarthritis. Right. Whenever the patient is suffering from the chronic diseases, we can use these drugs. Right. Whenever you see an inflammation, just put anti-inflammatory drugs. Right. The same thing, anti-analgesic. So we can combine these two properties. Whenever there is an inflammation, what will happen? Our pain will come. So whenever there is a pain, we can use these drugs for rheumatoid arthritis, right? For osteoarthritis, for gout. So let's use analgesic property more. Myalgia. Many of us would have heard about tablet called NICE in India, that is our Nimesulide. So that is anti-analgesic properties used there, right? So anywhere to avoid opiates, that's a major indication, right? Why? Because opiates have strong addictive action, so we can use these drugs as an analgesic property of the drug. So antipyretic, fever. So any fire type of fever we can use, right? But when I'm telling about fever, there is a note. Always remember, there is an important point about when you are using an aspirin for fever. When you are using aspirin for fever, don't use it for the child who is age is less than 12 or maybe 15 years old, because it can affect the liver and other majorly on the kidney and the liver. So that is a major properties of the drugs. So based on the anti-inflammatory, antipyretic, and analgesic properties, we can use these drugs widely, right? So let's discuss about side effects. Along with that, I will discuss also contraindications. So side effects, what are the side effects caused by NSAIDs? So NSAIDs cause side effect, how? They inhibit COX, especially non-selective ones, they cause GI toxicity. What it will do, it can lead to ulcers, right? And our prostaglandins also involved in the one of the major function, that is renal blood flow. Right. So whenever there is an impairment of renal blood flow, there can be kidney damage. Impairment of renal blood flow. Impairment of renal blood flow, GI toxicity, they increase the risk of bleeding. Increase risk of bleeding. And we have other side effects, such as majorly it's present for every drug, allergic reactions can be there. So this is there are many drugs which are highly allergic as in NSAIDs group. There are many people with the allergy of the NSAIDs, and contraindications when they are not indicated to the patient. That is, one is pregnancy and it is also contraindicated in a patient who is having hemophilia. And these are contraindicated in children. So children at the low age, especially aspirin is contraindicated. And one of the major use of this, like, you know, NSAIDs also includes one condition, that is patent ductus arteriosus. I have to tell you now, PDA. In patent ductus arteriosus, it is a congenital heart defect. There also our NSAIDs are used, and this is the story of our NSAIDs. Keep following. Thank you.